Now we are going to start with a new topic, that is the analytical chemistry, in which we will be taking up certain tests that how we can actually identify the substance or how can we know the exact composition of the substance. This is what is the analytical chemistry, right? So first of all, I want to make you familiar that what is actually the analysis. So the analysis is something, the determination of chemical components in a sample. Suppose I have a sample, right? I need to determine that what actually it contains, what chemical actually it contains is called as something the analysis. Now, the analysis are basically divided into two categories, that is the qualitative and the quantitative. As the name suggests, qualitative. Qualitative means we want to know that what actually it is composed of, right? So, identification of the unknown substance refers to qualitative analysis. And for how we do that? We do that by making performing certain tests by using some reagents, right? Now, the question must be striking that what is a reagent? So, the reagent is a substance which have the ability to react with another substance, right? And we have many common lab reagents like NaOH, NH4OH, KOH. There are many reagents, right, which are actually used to determine the any unknown substance or which helps in the qualitative analysis. So, it's clear that qualitative means to determine the unknown substance, and for that we do certain tests. Tests make use of certain reagents. Reagent is a substance which combines with the another substance, and we have few examples of different reagents, right? Now, the second type of analysis is the quantitative. Quantitative means quantity. That means we want to know the exact composition of the substances. Like if we know that, for example, I say I have CuSO4, copper sulfate. I say yes, it is formed of copper, sulfur and oxygen. So, it is the qualitative analysis. But when I refer to the composition actually, like it is present 60%, it is 20%, it is again 20%. So, it actually refers to the quantitative analysis. When we are just running in order to know the composition, exact percentage of the substance, that is something called as quantitative analysis. Now, we have, like as I told you, we do certain tests and we make use of certain reagents. So, we have some common reagents. Like, and you know that what common, like what category just form the common reagent, that is the bases and the alkalis. As you all are familiar that what are actually the bases and the alkalis, as I told you, in acid, base and salt. But still for this moment, I am just recalling that, base is a substance which has the tendency to release hydroxide ion when it is dissolved in water. Like, if anything, like suppose I have MOH, if I dissolve in water, and I get hydroxide ion, so particularly it refers that it is a base, right? So, any substance which when dissolved in water release an hydroxide ion, that is regarded as a base. So, I think it's clear, it's vanished from your mind, any other concept is vanished, it's just a substance which donates the hydroxide ion is regarded as a base. Now, the second thing is that what is an alkali? Actually, alkalis are derived from bases only. Those bases which are soluble in water, they are referred to as alkali. So, we can say that all bases are not soluble, so that means all bases are not alkalis, but all alkalis are particularly bases, right? So, it's quite a, you can say, an interesting fact that all bases are not alkalis, but definitely all alkalis are bases because they are actually derived from the base only and they have the power to donate the hydroxide ion, right? So, this is what is the base and the alkali. Now, if I refer to acidity, you must be familiar with the basicity concept. It seems to be a little, you can say, awkward type that when you say basicity of an acid. So, this must be coming in your mind that they are acids. Why we are clubbing this basic terms with that? So, actually the basicity of the acid, it's not required here, but still I'm telling you. Basicity of the acids are those that how many number of hydroxide ions, the hydrogen ion that acid can give, right? So, if an acid can give one hydrogen ion, we say it is monobasic. If it has the ability to give two hydroxide ions, we say it is dibasic. So, likewise, the bases have the acidity. Bases have the acidity. That means the power to give the hydroxide ion refers to the, this thing, the basicity of the, the acidity of the bases. So, what happens, like if some base have the ability to donate one hydroxide ion, then it is said to be monoacidic. And if it has the ability to give two hydroxide ion, it is said to be diacidic. It actually depends upon the number of the molecule. If one molecule gives one hydroxide ion, it is regarded as monoacidic. If one molecule gives two hydroxide ions, it is diastic. So likewise, as the focusing that how many hydroxide ions actually they are giving, we just classify them as monoacidic, diacidic, triacidic or polyacidic type. So this is the term actually. Now, as I told you that bases and alkalis have the power to get dissociate to form hydroxide ions, as I have done few for you. This is sodium hydroxide, your common name is caustic soda. Potassium hydroxide, common name caustic potash, calcium hydroxide, and this is ammonium hydroxide. So as I have shown that how they just get dissociates, right? So out of them, like out of all the alkalis or the bases, we have strong and weak bases. So what happens when a substance completely dissociates to give all its hydroxide ion, it is obviously regarded as a strong base. And if it gets partially dissociated, it is regarded as a weak base. For example, I am telling you, suppose I have this compound, I dissolve in water and it gets dissociate completely. I just mentioned the word completely. So when it gets dissociated completely, that means we cannot see this present in a solution. Everything is present in this form. So that is it, that means it is a strong base, right? But if I get to see that we get this, and also we get some unionized molecules of the base. So that means it is a weak base. So likewise, if it has a partial ability to get dissociated, it is a weak base. And if it has a complete ability to get dissociated, it is a strong base. So likewise, depending upon their power to dissociate, we can just classify them as strong or weak bases. Right. Now, coming on to salts. You know that when acid and base, that means acidic and basic substance react with each other, definitely they are going to form a neutral substance that is nothing but the salt. So salt is actually formed as a result of neutralization reaction between acid and a base. So if we talk about the colors of the salt, then you will be surprised to know that all the representative elements, what are representative elements? The elements which fall under S and P block. Right, they are like their salts are almost colorless, but the salts of the transition elements, that is the D block elements or F block elements, they are actually colored. So I'm just going to focus that what kind of color do they possess, and you should also have a basic idea related to that, because whenever you get a question you need to mention the color also, because whenever you are performing a test we identify the substance with the color, because we cannot see the iron ions floating in the solution, we won't see copper ions floating in a solution or getting depositing on something, right? We are just confirming them by the colors, right? So we need to focus on the colors also. So when we talk about the colors of the transition elements, copper has blue color, iron 2 positive, the ferrous means light green, Fe3 positive yellow, nickel 2 positive green, chromium 2 positive again green, manganese 2 positive pink. So I think you can easy way to remember it, iron, this nickel and chromium all are green. The only matter is that iron 2 positive is light green or a dirty green, you may see written somewhere. And manganese is obviously pink, and I think it's clear because alkaline KMnO4 was pink in color, and that pink color was actually due to Mn2 positive. So I think you can learn this also. And copper is blue, and this is actually from the previous classes you are always learning copper salts, and you know that the copper color is like copper salt color is actually blue, but whenever it is present in a metal form it is red in color, you should know that also. And so MnO4 again pink, chromium orange, and chromate yellow. So you need to learn all those things. Now the colorless one are all the salts of representative elements, that is the S and the P, Na positive, calcium, chloride ion, magnesium ion, potassium ion, sulfates, carbonate, sulfide. Actually the space was too short to list more, so but you keep in mind that the salts of representative elements are generally colorless, that means the white in color. So this is what actually we have this analysis. So these are actually the basic things you should know. So I think it's clear. Analysis, what is analysis? Qualitative, quantitative, clear, reagents is clear. I have told you the common reagents are bases and alkalis. I told you about an acidity. I told you about strong and weak bases. I think it's clear. And we have also talked about already talked about the colors of the salts. So just keep in mind that the salts of representative elements are colorless and generally, right, but the salts of the transition elements are somewhat colored in nature.